Masturbation protects from prostate cancer. Doctor's orders, make it your new hobby. Clickbait? Not at all. I will prove it to you with science. I went through some of the largest studies myself. The message is consistent. Masturbation is key. If you are very religious, you may want to know, does sex count as well? I will be addressing this, but also the important question of how many times you have to do it. And some interesting findings. Masturbation at young age has been associated with increased prostate cancer risk in some studies. Don't worry, I have an explanation and a simple tip based on that explanation. So join me on a tour where we touch a topic that's touchy in itself, masturbation. I'm Dr. Stefan Buntrock, board-certified urologist and specialist in sexual health. Let's dive in. Why is masturbation a taboo? Here's the short version. The Roman Catholic Church made it a sin during the Middle Ages and criminalized it in 1768. The year 1712 marks a best-selling pamphlet, Onania, or the heinous sin of self-pollution by John Martin, a self-declared physician and author from England, more quack than healer. That really got things going, and the 18th and 19th centuries witnessed a crusade against masturbation. So, how do you enforce a prohibition? You make up a lot of stuff to create a deterrent effect. You know what I'm talking about, going to hell, hairy palms, madness, etc. We are living in the 21st century. Masturbation myths are more alive than ever. Fascinating and somehow tragic. So what happens if you don't masturbate? From a medical perspective, nothing. But the real question is a different one. What happens if you masturbate a lot? From a medical perspective, does it make a difference? Yes, obviously, we have large-scale data showing an important health benefit with masturbation. It protects from prostate cancer. Let me be clear. Saying it protects doesn't mean 100%. It means it lowers the risk significantly. Do you want an impressive database? How about this? 222,426 years of follow-up with 1,449 new cases of prostate cancer and 29,342 US men in the health professionals follow-up study. This is data of high quality because it doesn't look back on what has happened. It records what will happen in the future. We call this prospective. And since the participants are accompanied over many years, the quality of the data is very high. This is one of the less frequently done longitudinal studies. The participants were to report their frequency of ejaculation during their phases of life. That part looked back in time, but it also included the present. I know what you're thinking. Can past and present predict the future? Absolutely. If you want to know how many times you have to ejaculate to lower your personal prostate cancer risk, I have a number for you for warm-up. The number is 2. That's one click on the subscribe button and one click on the like button. Because if you like my content, show it. In real life, you would clap. On YouTube, you like and subscribe. Liking and subscribing is digital applause. Thank you. Okay, the number 21. If you ejaculate 21 times or more per month, you lower your prostate cancer risk by 33%. What is the benchmark? I bet you thought it was 0, but it wasn't. The control group were men who ejaculated 4 to 7 times per month. I think now you begin to comprehend why I initially told you to make it your new hobby. The effect was more pronounced in the older age groups. What could be the explanation? Let me throw in a few facts about prostate cancer here. It is a disease of the aging male. Most men will be diagnosed beyond the age of 50. However, we are far from understanding its natural course. Some men will start to develop prostate cancer cells already in their 20s. With aging, this proportion will start to grow. What we yet have to figure out is why and when. Plus, some cancers are not that dangerous. So how come some get magically activated while others don't? This is why finding an increased protective effect in older men is huge. The health professionals' follow-up study is not one of a kind. The results I just reported were published in 2004. The CAPLIFE study is a very recent one. It is a so-called case-control study that was published in 2023. A case-control study has a group that's observed and that's compared with a reference group. Every person in the study group has a control in the reference group. In the CAPLIFE study, there were 456 cases of prostate cancer and 427 controls. The study was methodologically solid. In general, the main finding was the same as in the previous study. Masturbation decreases prostate cancer risk. It was lowered by an amazing 58% with just 4 or more ejaculations per month. Yeah, I understand, that's a tricky one. The reference group was 0 to 3 ejaculations per month. While the general finding is the same, the details are contradictory. I mean, 4 to 7 ejaculations per month was the control group in the health professionals follow-up study. The problem becomes obvious when looking at study design. It's like comparing apples with oranges. A case control study can't be compared to a longitudinal prospective trial. A case control study is generally considered less robust in scientific evidence. To begin with, it is retrospective. It looks in the past, not the future. It doesn't establish causality like the longitudinal study. Instead, it looks at associations and a couple of other things. That's why these two designs can't be directly compared, even though they point in the same direction. But how? How can masturbation be protective? Would it also work with ordinary sex? Short answer, yes. The body doesn't really care about the means an ejaculation is brought about, because the ejaculate itself may be the aggressor. One of the most discussed explanations for why ejaculation might protect the prostate is the so-called prostate stagnation hypothesis. The idea is simple. If semen and prostatic fluid are not regularly released, metabolic byproducts, dead cells, inflammatory agents, and possibly even carcinogens could accumulate inside the gland. This stagnation may create a microenvironment that promotes chronic inflammation and cellular stress. Not good, because both are known risk factors for cancer development. Regular ejaculation, in contrast, is thought to act like a clearance mechanism, flushing out potentially harmful substances and keeping the gland physiologically active. While this hypothesis is still under investigation, it offers a plausible biological rationale that links sexual activity to long-term prostate health. And maybe this is why the data speak so clearly, not just once, but again and again. This video won't end before I reveal a finding from another case control study. It was published in the British Journal of Urology International in 2008. It looked at 431 men with prostate cancer and 409 controls. Just to give you an idea about the scientific quality of this study, it was less than in the CAPLIFE study, because here are the shocking numbers. Frequent masturbation and sex from 20 to 29 was associated with an increased risk of prostate cancer. That risk was elevated by 79%. In men 30 to 39 years, it was still elevated by 69%. That woke you up, didn't it? However, I don't think you should be worried. It was a retrospective study. There are some methodological problems with that. But apart from this, I think more or less all studies miss an important point. Sexually transmitted infections. We know that viruses can cause cancer. We know that the human papillomavirus causes cervical cancer in women and penile cancer in men. The question is, can it also cause prostate cancer in men? Ideally, one would have a group of men who live celibate. No wonder there has been an increased interest in Catholic priests. From the US, there are some studies showing that their incidence of prostate cancer is lower than in the general population. However, one recent study didn't find a difference. I think the problem is this. Now that we have a celibate population, we would need them to masturbate, And in Catholic priests, that would be a sin, that's for sure. I don't think it will be possible to get a reliable picture. So back to the sexually active young men. I mean, in theory, prostate cancer risk could be increased. More sexual activity equals more STI risk. That could be a ticking time bomb. And it leads to the question, could HPV also cause prostate cancer? That's a hot topic right now, and it justifies a separate video. You can watch it here. I will upload it soon if it is not visible yet. As you can see from this video, medicine is not only facts. It is also culture, because doctors are not robots. They are as human as anybody else. And then there is religion and the usual online buzz. I'm a doctor and science is my guide. The internet is a swamp. Follow me. I know the way.